It's a new level. A new beginning. If you believe that, shout a louder amen. I want to thank God for that message in song through the mouth of the choir, the testimony choir. We pray that the testimony of God will never cease in your mouth in the name of Jesus. Let us pray together. Father, we thank you because it's a new level, it's a new beginning. Thank you for the great opportunity you've given unto us to enter into this new beginning. We appreciate you for this great privilege. Thank you for all that you have done for us. We return all glory unto you, Father, be exalted in the name of Jesus. Lord, as we continue this new beginning, we pray that your grace will be made available for us in the name of Jesus. We want to hear your word again, O God, your word of transformation, your word of healing, your word of miracle, your word of favor, your word of promotion. We ask, O God, this morning, may your word visit us afresh in the name of Jesus. All that we need in this new beginning, may you release upon our lives in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. We give you all the glory. Thank you for the choir you have used, we pray. You will continue to bless them and continue to empower them. May your name continually be glorified in our lives. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. We are reading this morning from the book of Ruth again. But this time around, I will do some selective reading because of time. So I will read from Ruth chapter 2, and I will take some verses. The first verses I will take is 2 to 3. So follow me as I read. I'm using the International Standard Version. Ruth, the Moabite, told Naomi, please allow me to go out to the field and glean grain behind anyone who shows me kindness. So Naomi replied, go ahead, my daughter. So she went out and proceeded to the field and gleaned behind the harvesters. And it happened that she came to the portion of the land belonging to Boaz of the family of Elimelech. Chapter 6, verse 7. She asked us, please allow me to glean what is left of the grain behind the harvesters. So she came out and has continued walking from dawn until now, except for a short time in a shelter. I will jump to 15 to 18. After she had left to glean, Boaz commanded his servants, allow her to glean also among the cut sheep, and don't taunt her. One other thing, draw some handful deliberately, leaving them for her so she can gather it and don't bother her. 17. So Ruth gathered grain out in the field until dusk and then threshed what she had gathered. After about a week's supply of barley, she picked up her grain and went back to town. Her mother-in-law noticed how much Ruth had gleaned and had brought back from what was left over from our lunch. May the Lord bless the reading of his words into our hearts, into our lives, in the name of Jesus. We are in the month of a new beginning, and of the truth, the Lord is showing us many new beginnings. My prayer is your new beginning will never pass you by in the name of Jesus. We have learned a lot from the life of Ruth. We have learned, for example, the subject of commitment, commitment to God, commitment in marriage. We have learned from the life of Ruth. This morning, we are learning a new thing from the life of Ruth when we talk about the issue of a new beginning. And I trust God that as we learn this new thing, this new lesson from our life, the Lord himself will challenge our lives. That we will not just listen to this message, we will not just listen to these words, but I will make up our mind to be doers of the word in the name of Jesus. Ruth From the narrative we've been studying, we find ourselves in a very trying situation. The situation we find ourselves was a very trying one. Time will not permit me to begin to analyze, but you all know, because we have been looking at the story of Ruth from the beginning of the month. You know some of the things she went through. No doubt it was a trying situation. Just like some of us are also going through one trying situation or the other. Particularly for all the citizens of this world, COVID-19 has brought to us a lot of challenges, a lot of trying situations, things we have never experienced before, we are experiencing for the very first time. We've not been compelled to do certain things like this before, but COVID-19 has made some of those things to happen to us. So no doubt, it is a trying situation for everybody, one way or the other. So in the same way, Ruth also finds herself in a very trying situation. The situation she found herself was a situation that some people will have decided to take a very demeaning choice or make a very demeaning decision. But Ruth did not. For instance, the trying situations of people find themselves these days have made them to devise some means that are ungodly to tackle their situations. Some people have resorted into scam. That's why today, people that scam, they are increasing in our society. Some people have decided to look for wayward means to take care of their challenges. Ruth did not use wayward means. If some people find themselves in the situation of Ruth, they will just resort to wayward means to take care of themselves. Ruth did not resort to wayward means. Some people will decide to complain and open their mouth and begin to complain and begin to blame every other person except themselves. Ruth did not complain. Ruth did not resort to that. But she took one step that is so crucial for us to take note of this morning. And that step is a crucial step that every one of us should take note of this morning. And as we take note of that crucial step, it will help us to also do some of the things she did. And if we do them, of course, we will have good results. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And what was that crucial step? It is the step of hard work. That is introducing us to our topic this morning, industry. Can I hear you with me? Can I hear you with me? Industry. Ruth was a very industrious woman. If you look at verse 7, Bible says she asked us, that was the servant of Boaz, when he asked about Ruth, and he reported about her, that she asked us, please, allow me to glean what is left of the grain behind the harvester. So she came out and had continued working from dawn up till now. That was a picture of a very hardworking woman. A picture of a woman who knows the value of work. So the servants, as they are reporting to their master, we are giving a report about Ruth, that she started working from dawn up till now, except for a short time of rest under the shelter. She worked under the sun, she worked under the rain, she worked under the harsh weather. She was working and she did not rest. And she had been working up till now. That's a very industrial person. The word industry comes from the Latin word industra, which means diligence and hard work. Diligence and hard work. So the primary meaning includes a persevering determination to perform a task. When you talk about industry, you talk about a persevering determination to perform a task. And I want you to take note of that word, persevering determination to perform a task. Ruth demonstrated an example of industry. She shows to us an example of somebody who values work. Unfortunately, today in our society is becoming a society where people don't value work again. Our society is gradually becoming a society where work is becoming like a cost. That's why when you move around in our society, you see a lot of things about work. And it baffles me. Everywhere you enter, whether government establishment or private establishment, you see the way we handle work. We are not meticulous about handling our work. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And unfortunately, it's becoming the order of the day. That's why everywhere you enter now, it's who you know that matters. You go to the hospital, you need connection. You go to the bank, you need connection. You enter the hospital, you must know somebody before you attend there to. You go to the bank, you must know somebody. Somebody is supposed to attend to you, and instead of attending to you, is busy doing other things. That begins to show to me that the value of work is reducing in our society. A situation where people are looking for opportunity to cut corners in terms of work. Pile up jobs that you are supposed to do, and you decide to pile it, put it in one corner. And you are only praying that time for closure should come so that you can just close and go. Ruth shows to us that it is good to be industrious. May the Lord open our eyes to learn from Ruth in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
She followed the Mosaic law as recorded in the book of Leviticus chapter 19, verse 9 to 10. And what that law states is when you want to harvest, don't harvest everything on your farm. There are some at the margin that you must leave purposely for those who are poor. Those that fall on the floor, you don't pick, leave it for those who are poor. That was the law that Ruth worked upon. She noticed it, she took hold of it, and she worked upon it. And so that gives us that Ruth herself was somebody who values work, because she did not just sit down and begin to complain and begin to look at the situation of her life, what has happened to her, and was waiting for people to come and console her, waiting for people to come and pity her. No. She searched inwardly and she asked herself, what is the way forward? Well, this is the way forward. And so she took hold of that opportunity and pursued it. She did not make herself a beggar. Because actually some people in that situation will have decided to beg. She did not beg. Why did she not beg? Maybe one of the reasons why she did not beg is that she has come to discover that begging does not actually solve the problem of any individual. When you beg, the highest you can get from begging is just to meet just this morning for a while. You will still come back to begging again. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. She did not resort to begging. Begging should be discouraged, especially by Christians. But when you also look into our society today, you see that begging is becoming a new way of life. Stylish way of life. Anything for the boys. Praise the Lord. Bros, anything for the boys. Ruth did not beg. She did not ask anything for the woman. Anything for this widow, no. She did not beg. Why we see that people are begging today, it still results back to the issue of the value of work has dropped drastically in our society. There is one word we use in those days. I don't know whether we are still familiar with it. We call it fine back. Is it still familiar? Okay. Maybe those of us that live in the north will understand it. Fine back. Bara is an outside word for begging. So they modernized it and call it fine bara. How does fine bara operate? Fine bara operates. Somebody can just see you and say, "Bro, good afternoon, sir. I came to visit my brother here. And when I got there, he has traveled. And I don't know any other person again. Please, I need transport." And you give him. Tomorrow again, you will see him. Will have forgotten that you are the same person he spoke with yesterday. Have you ever experienced those kind of things before?
Yeah.
Fine bara. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Fine bara. What about those who will use the language, "We are still loyal"? When they use that language, they are still begging for something. Fine bara. Ruth did not resort to that. So, I believe that as Christians, we should fight against the spirit of begging, but the spirit of begging is not the spirit of Christ. Rather, the spirit of Christ is the spirit of industry. And if we are going to maximize our new beginning, we must understand that the spirit of industry must take over our lives. We must be willing to work. We must be willing to do something. We must be willing to use our hands to do something. Even though it's a new beginning, the economy is opening up newly, and of course, there are a lot of things that have happened before now, but we are entering into a new beginning. And of course, in this new beginning, there are opportunities in this new beginning. And I pray to God that God will open your eyes to those opportunities in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
But you must make up your mind like Ruth, who will not beg. You must make up your mind like Ruth, who will not take a demeaning decision of what she wants to do with her life. That she will not resort to taking a step that will reduce her dignity, that will reduce her person, that will reduce who God has made her to be, irrespective of what she was going through. What she was going through does not matter. What matters is she must take steps to better her life now and for the future. And that step is the step of industry. May the Lord help us to be industrious in the name of Jesus. Listen to what somebody says about the issue of giving and or begging. He said, "To give something for nothing is always a dangerous piece of business." I want to take that statement again. To give something for nothing is always a dangerous piece of business. This is the Bible commentator. So maybe you don't think like one believer that is talking. Then he went further. He said, "Sometimes we must do it. It is true, but it is not the ideal kind of benevolence. So when we do it sometimes, because it's a must to do, it is not an ideal kind of benevolence. There are times that even as a church, we have to do some of these things, but this man is saying it is not an ideal kind of benevolence, even though we do it sometime." He went further to say, "If you desire to do something for the poor, that will endure," underline the word, "that will endure." Something for the poor that will endure. He said, "Let them do something to end which that which they receive from you." Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Are we following this morning?
Yeah.
May the Lord help us.
Yeah.
I say, may the Lord help us.
Yeah.
Sometimes, some good works you do, if you don't do it properly, you are not helping the person you are working for, and you are helping. That's what this person is saying, that it must be done properly, and that is allowing the person to do something in return. I pray that God will grant us understanding in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Well, this morning, I will point out certain things about industrious people that we can connect to into, to enter into this new beginning we are talking about, and of course, to have a prosperous beginning. I pray that as the choir has sung, that is a new level. The Lord will take us to a new level in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In our thinking, the Lord will take us to a new level in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because I quickly want to say that the first new level we must enter into starts from our thinking, our thoughts, our mentality. And that was what we see in the life of Ruth. She had a good mentality. That's why she chose industry. If her mentality was wrong, she would have chosen begging. If her mentality was wrong, she would have chosen a wayward means of making money. But she had the right mentality, and so she chose rightly. And as we trust God, I pray that God will grant us a good mentality in the name of Jesus. I say God will grant us a good mentality in the name of Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now, before I mention this point, I want to mention, one of them I want to mention, permit me to say again, because I perceive God impressing in my heart this issue of our mentality must change to the kind of people we are. If we don't believe God, that the God we serve is able to meet our needs, there is no how God himself can help us. That's why the Bible says, without faith, it is what? It is impossible to do what? To please God. It is impossible. If your mentality does not change to believe God, that the whole of your problem in life and eternity can be taken over by God, and to help you are in trouble. If the focus of your receiving help here on earth is human beings, I want to tell you that you are in trouble, because human beings will not help you. Even if they help you and God has not helped you, the help of man will drag you down the more. So we must have the right mentality when we talk about God, especially in a season like this, with what we are going through now. We must have the right mentality, putting our focus on God, relying on God to be our help, not looking at your neighbor, not looking at even the government, not looking at all the people around you, but focusing on God, that it is only God that can help you. And when God wants to help you, he can use anybody. Praise the Lord. He can do what? He can do what? He can use anybody. That's why when Ruth was going out and she was speaking to her mother-in-law, she said, please, I want to go out. He says, I want to go to the field, but adventure, I can receive favor from anyone. It was not particularly tied to any individual. What she was going out for was looking for favor from the sight of God. And she knew that the favor can come from anyone. She depended solely on God. On who are you depending? On God? On yourself? Or on man? You depend on man, you fail. You depend on yourself, you fail. You depend on God, you succeed. I pray for you this morning, you will succeed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say you will succeed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The choir sang a while ago, they said, a new speed. A new speed. A new speed will come when you depend and put your life totally in the hands of God, trusting him that he is the owner of your life, and he will take you to the next level. And I trust God, he will help you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say we'll help you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So this morning, quickly, 4 points that I saw from the industry of roots. Number one, industrious people easily identify opportunities. Industrious people easily identify opportunities. If you look at Ruth chapter 2 to 3, Bible says Ruth told the Moabite, told Naomi, please allow me to go out to the field and glean grain behind anyone who show me kindness. So Naomi replied, go ahead, my daughter. So she went out and proceeded to the field and gleaned behind the harvesters. And it happened that she came to the portion of the land belonging to Boaz, the family of Elimelech. She saw opportunity because she was industrious. She was able to sight an opportunity and she was able to make use of it. When you see an individual who is industrious, they quickly notice opportunity. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. No matter how we complain about our society, there are still a lot of opportunities over there begging to be tapped. There are still a lot of things that people are doing or people have not seen that they can do to make money, but those opportunities are still lying fallow over there. It takes industry for you to be able to sight that opportunity and to be able to make use of it. Ruth sighted the opportunity. She made good use of this. This season does not call for complaining. It calls for industry. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Complaining, somebody says, is an ineffective response to an event that does not produce a better outcome. No matter how much you complain, it does not produce a better outcome. You will just be complaining, and instead of even producing a better outcome, you'll be making more enemies for yourselves. Praise the Lord. Instead of complaining now, look for opportunities around you. If you are industrious, you will see a lot of things around you that you can use to make money. May the Lord open your eyes to those opportunities in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say, may the Lord open your eyes to those opportunities in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
It does not matter how small the opportunity is. But opportunity is opportunity. As you thought, you will think that it was only Ruth who was able to cite opportunity. But no, Bible gives us example of people like David, who was also an industrious person. How did I know that David was industrious? David was industrious to the intent that when they came to anoint king, David was not available. He was in the bush, taking care of his father's sheep. Of all the children of what's the name of his father now? Jesse. Thank you for reminding me. David was the most industrious of all. So when the opportunity came, he went to the battlefield to visit his brothers, and he saw an opportunity on the field. Whereas all the brothers, they had seen obstacles. All the other armies on the field, they had seen obstacles. But when David came, he saw an opportunity. And the man said, what will be done for the man who can fight with this man? And they told him what will be done. And the guy said, well, I will fight with him. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And you know the story. He fought with the man. And he was able to overcome that obstacle. What you call an obstacle can be an opportunity in disguise. That problem that you see that is confronting you, that problem might be an opportunity that God is bringing your way. But what was it that made it easy for David to confront Goliath? It was because before then, David had been so industrious, working in the wilderness, working where nobody was taking note of him. And then when he saw Goliath, he said, God that has helped me to deal with the lions and the bears in the wilderness, he will also give me the power to deal with these unconcerned Philistines. Industry opens you up for opportunity. When you are industrious, opportunities will always come your way. I pray to you, I pray to God this morning that the Lord will open your eyes in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I said the Lord will open your eyes in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Number two, industrious people get noticed. You notice them easily. Look at Ruth chapter 2, verse 5. Bible says, at this point, Boaz asked the foreman of the harvester, to whom does this young woman belong? You will think that it was because she was beautiful. No. You will think that it was because she was the only one there. No. There were other young women there. That's why if you read that scripture, you will see that even Boaz was telling the young woman, say, please, just stick to the woman's servants. So there are other women there. But how come that this woman was noticed easily? It was because she was industrious. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Are you industrious? If you enter any establishment and you see a hardworking person, you will quickly notice that person. When you go to a bank, maybe you go to deposit or you go to collect. You, if you see an industrial seller, you will know easily. True of us? Huh? True. I know them. Because when I get to a bank, I don't join queues anyhow. I will look at the queue first and look at the one that is moving fast. When I see the one that is moving fast, I know that the teller at the end of that, at that point, is an industrious one. It's a teller who will attend to you quickly, not the one who will be looking at the computer screen and see if the computer screen is running away. There are some tellers that as the customer comes, they attend to the customer in no distant time, it's true. And they go, and that one go, and that one come. Before you know, everybody is going. But the other one can just be so slow. He's just looking at the computer and see if the computer is not working. No. He's just doing that one purposely so that the number of persons he or she will attend to will not be so much. And then by so doing, he will not do hard work until closing time. Praise the Lord. Some of the things they are supposed to post when they are finished closing their work, they will decide to post it while you are there. So that immediately they close the door for banking, they themselves will just stand up and go. But that's not what they are paid for. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, I'm sorry if I'm attacking bankers. Maybe it's because we relate with them. Praise the Lord. But you also find them in another sector. May the Lord change our work ethics in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say may the Lord change our work ethics in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
But when you see those cross people, you notice them easily. So Ruth was noticed. I pray for you this morning. Your industry will make people to notice you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That's if you have one. If you have one, that industry will make people notice you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Whether as a teacher, your industry will make people notice you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Whether as a banker, your industry will make people notice you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
As a doctor, whatever work you do, your industry will open door that people will notice your good work in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I remember in those days when we used to be in the north, there used to be one industrial traffic warning. You can never see traffic jam whenever that man is on the junction. Why? Because by the time he begins to conduct the traffic, he will use his head, he will use his leg, he will use his arm, he will use everything, and you see him like this. And everybody is, and all the traffic is going. Everybody's, and before you know what is happening, people start dashing the guy money. They start throwing money at him, and he's very happy being industrious. Because industrious people get noticed. If you are complaining in your place of work, they don't notice you. Maybe it's because you are not in those souls. And nobody is even taking notice of me. I don't know. Maybe it's because they don't know you are not industrious. Even in the family, among children, when you see a child who is very industrious, that child gets noticed by the parents. That's why in some families you will see that one person is always being sent to do something all the time. It is not for anything. It's not because the parents don't like all the children. It's not because the parents don't like that person. But because of the industrial nature of that person that makes the parents to notice that person and send him on the errand most of the time. So instead of complaining, instead of grumbling, check yourself. Maybe you are not industrious enough. May the Lord help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Listen to what Proverbs 22, verse 29 says. It says, "Fear that a man diligent in his business, he shall stand before kings. He shall not stand before mean men." Number three, industrious people get favor. Why else do I do? You say I'm favored. Yes, but I show you how to get favor. To get favor comes from industry. Look at verse 8 of chapter 2. It says, "First, then address fruit." He said, "Listen, my daughter, don't glean in any other field. Don't even leave this one. Be sure to stay close to my women's servants." In other words, you have received favor. There's no need for you to go up and down. Say, "Here, there is favor for you here." And of course, she received favor. Look at another one. Let's jump to verses 14 and 15. He says, "At lunch time, Boaz invited her," that is Ruth now. He said, "Come now over, ask some food, dip your bread in our oil and vinegar." So she sat down beside the harvesters, and he handed her some roasted grain, which she ate until she was satisfied. She kept what was left over. After she had left to glean, Boaz commanded his servant, "Allow her to glean also among the court sheep, and do not taunt her." That's evil. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. When she started by gleaning from those that fell on the floor. Accidentally, those that fell on the floor. But because she has been noticed, because she has received favor, the owner of the feast says, deliberately because of her, let certain things fall on the ground so that she can avenge from those that have fallen on the ground. That's evil. When you start being industrious with your life, initially things might look difficult, but as you go on, the favor of the Lord begins to attend to your way. And before you know what is happening, what was difficult before will become much, much easier. So when he gave that command, life became much, much easier for Ruth. So industrious people get favored. I pray for you this morning that may the Lord favor you in the name of Jesus. I say may the Lord favor you in the name of Jesus. Maybe you have been so industrious and it appears as if favor is far away from you. I pray for you this morning that your industry will open door of favor for you in the name of Jesus. I say your industry will open door of favor for you in the name of Jesus. When we talk about favor, it's like unmerited grace. What you do not merit, but it is something that preceded that grace. Your industry will make grace fall upon you. May the Lord favor you this season in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Number four, industrious people get promoted. Ruth chapter 2, verse 16. Boaz was speaking here. He said, "One other thing." He said, "Draw some hard food deliberately, leaving them for her so that she can gather it and don't bother."
deliberately drop handful of others for her. She was promoted. She was promoted from somebody who gleaned, from what just fell accidentally, to somebody who can now advance from what was purposely put aside for her. That was promotion for her. As hard as this season may be for so many people, I pray that your hard work will promote you in the name of Jesus. I say your hard work will promote you in the name of Jesus. Where there seems to be no promotion, may you receive promotion in the name of Jesus. Proverbs 12, verse 24 says, hard work, he said, work hard, you will be a leader. Be lazy, and you will end up a slave. I take it again. Work hard, you will be a leader. Be lazy, and you will end up a slave. May you not end up a slave in the name of Jesus. I say, may you not end up a slave in the name of Jesus. But amen alone does not solve this matter. What solves this matter, or what can solve this matter, is what the Bible says earlier on. It says, work hard. Let me tell your neighbor, work hard. Tell her well. Tell her well. Tell her well. Work hard. Work hard. If somebody comes to you and says, give me money, ask the person, what kind of work are you doing first? Because the culture is work hard. And it is only those who work hard, the Bible says, they will be leaders. Those who don't work, the Bible says, they will end up slaves. Work hard. May the Lord help us to work in the name of Jesus. Amen. Listen to what somebody says. He says, the better you know your business, the more you are likely to rise. The better you know your business, the more you are likely to rise. This does not affect those that are working alone. It affects students. Students in the house, students watching me online, work hard, you will be a leader. Laziness makes you a slave. If you are a student and you cannot work hard, you cannot study, you cannot give time to study while your mates are busy working, wanting to better their future, you are lazing around, sleeping. At the end of the day, you will become a slave. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. You know the culture today? The culture today is some people will go and beg lecturer in order to pass. But whether you pass and come out with that good certificate does not make you great. Any certificate that you fail to work for, when you come to the field, it will show. That's why you can tell some people to write letter, they can't write letter, ordinary letter. A student cannot write letter, or a graduate cannot write letter. Applications some people cannot write. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Why would they write? Because they cannot write, because they did not write. When they were in school, they are supposed to write, they refused to write. They begged lecturer to pass. Today, many parents are sorting out for their children. You are destroying them. You are destroying their future. Because you will not always be with these children for the rest of their lives. They will pass through their own challenges in life. And it is some of those stress they have gone through in the academics that will make them to stand when they are facing those challenges. I want to believe that under the sound of my voice this morning, there is no parent who goes out to help his child or a child when the child wants to write exams. If you do that, you are a disappointment to that child. The Christian ethics is to work hard. That's why the Bible tells us that when you are diligent, you will become a leader. But if you are lazy, you become a slave. It's not by prayer, no amount of prayer you pray. If you are lazy, you become a slave. The Bible says God honors his word more than his name. He respects his word. He will not break his principle. His principles are the same from generation to generation. Civilization does not break the principle of God. What he has spoken, he has spoken. Nothing changes it. One of the reasons why my nation is going back every day is because we don't know the value of work. Hence, we are going backward. Until we begin to value work and give time to the work we are doing and be industrious with our lives, then leadership opportunity might be far away from us. I pray that every leadership opportunity that the Lord has prepared your way will not pass you by in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say it will not pass you by in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So please, I beg you, work hard, because you will get promoted. Your hard work will bring promotion your way. And if you have been working hard and you have not been promoted, I pray for you this morning, the Lord will remember you.
Amen.
I say the Lord will remember you.
Amen.
And you will be promoted soon in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say you will be promoted soon in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
As I conclude this morning, Ruth's narrative is a challenge to every one of us today. And life is a challenge to us. Especially this morning, as we look at our industrious nature, he's challenging us. He's challenging us not to live our lives anyhow and make ourselves beggars or make ourselves people who don't know the value of work. It is necessary to note that a good spirit of industry will prompt you not to work for your benefit alone. She did not work for her benefit alone because she was industrious. That's why in verse 18, the Bible told us that she picked up her grain and went back to town. Her mother-in-law noticed how much Ruth brought in a single day, without fraud, everything through hard work. And the mother noticed it. Maybe you will ask yourself, do I want to make my life to have meaning? Yes. If yes is the answer, then the next thing is, how do I work to make my life meaningful? That's what Ruth told us. She worked and she became a very purposeful human being who lives life to impact other people for her life. Otherwise, she would have entered Israel and told herself, after all, my mother-in-law brought me to Israel. And because she brought me to Israel, take care of me. But she did not do that. She worked and she made meaning not only for her life, but also for the life of her mother-in-law. Your purpose is to work to impact the kingdom of God. As I conclude this morning, what impact are you having on the kingdom of God? Everyone of us that is here should ask ourselves that question. What impact do I have on the kingdom of God? In what area am I impacting the kingdom of God positively? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's a new beginning. But we maximize that new beginning when we know our impact in the kingdom of God. In what area am I impacting this kingdom? In my family, in what area am I impacting my family? In my society, in what area am I impacting my society? Ruth made impact. She had problems, no doubt about it. She found herself in a very serious, terrible situation that nobody will ever pray for. But then, she made impact. What impact am I making? So far, we are still alive. God still wants us to continue to make impact. Until when we die, we finish the task. Before then, impact we must continue to make. The easiest way to make impact is to be industrious in our lives. Do something with your life. Every time you go, do something. I'm not hearing you. It's a new beginning, do what? It's a new beginning, do what? It's a new beginning, do what?
You are a living being, you are not stone. It is only stone that does occupy space. Living beings are human beings that walk and have impacts. Do something with your life and impact your generation for God. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. As I close this morning, the first thing we need to do to begin to have impact is to connect to Jesus if you are not connected to Him. That's the first work we will do. Get connected to Jesus. After that, keep working every day. Be industrious with your life. Even searching how to know Him the better every day. By prayers, by studying the Word of God, be industrious. Even in those spiritual things, it will connect you to your progress, it will connect you to your prosperity, it will connect you to this new beginning, and you will maximize to the glory and honor of the Lord. As you do that, I trust God, it shall be well with you in the name of Jesus. I say, it shall be well with you in the name of Jesus. Please, let's stand as we pray together. Let's stand as we pray together. Touch my life with His hands, my life changed. Touch my life with His hands, my life began anew. Oh, Jehovah, touch my life. He touched my life. Hallelujah. Tell Him to touch your life afresh. Tell Him to touch your life afresh, so that your life can change for Him. Tell Him to touch your life. Let Him touch your life afresh this morning. He wants to touch your life afresh. Oh, Jehovah wants to touch our lives afresh. Tell Him to touch your life afresh. Tell Him to touch your life afresh. There's any area in your life that you need strength, ask Him to strengthen that area of your life. There's any area of your life that you know you are not doing more, you are not doing as you are supposed to do, ask Him to give you grace, ask Him to touch that area. Let Him touch your life this morning. Let Him touch your life this morning. Let Him touch your life. He wants to touch your life with His hands so that your life can change for Him. Oh, thank you, Father. Or maybe you have been struggling, and you are not getting good results for your labor. Why don't you ask God this morning? Because you say in your word that if I work hard, I will be the leader. God, promote me. Lift up your voice and talk to God. Promote me. Promote me in this area. Mention that area where you need promotion, so that God can touch that area of your life with His promotion from above. Lord, we pray, O God, Father, that Lord, everyone who is working hard without commensurate results, I pray this morning you will touch their life, O God. Touch their life, O God, with your power. The power of transformation. Touch their lives, O God, with your power of transformation. Thank you, Father, because we know you are touching our life this morning. We are touching our life this morning. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. Thank you for the challenge that you have given us from your word. As we go back over, Father, to put this words into practice, we pray we will stand out wherever we find ourselves in the name of Jesus. As Christians, oh God, we pray that we will demonstrate our Christian virtue wherever we walk in the name of Jesus. That through, oh God, our industrial spirit, people will notice us for your own glory in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask, oh God, every favor that attend to good work, may those favor, oh God, attend to us in the name of Jesus. Lord, the promotion, oh God, Father, that is for those who are diligent, I pray, Father, that promotion will be given to us in the name of Jesus. We pray this morning, if there's anyone who has been working and yet there's no commensurate result,
result of their work. I pray this morning you will open, oh God, your door of favor over their lives in the name of Jesus. Lord, we trust you, oh Father, for divine transformation in our lives in the name of Jesus. As we continue in this new beginning, oh God, everything that we need to do to maximize this new beginning, may you open our eyes to do them in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. We give you all the glory because you are the truth. We worship and exalt you. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.